Good evening and welcome everyone to this next yet another program of the STEP program, the Star Teachers in Plastic Surgery, the Next Generation. Today being the 13th episode of season one. The first talk will be Approach to Condylar Fractures, and the speaker will be Dr. Surya Rao. He has done his MCH from Chengalpattu Medical College, Chengalpattu. He is right now the professor and head, Department of Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery and the Savita Institute of Plastic Reconstructive Aesthetic and Craniofacial Surgery. He is the chief coordinator and project director of the CIPRAX Cleft Care Program. And his main fields of interest are facio-maxillary, burn and hand surgery. Without further ado, I will hand over to Professor J. Jaganmohan, who will be moderating this program. He is the professor and head of the Department of Plastic Reconstructive and Facio-Maxillary Surgery at the Rajiv Gandhi Government General Hospital and Madras Medical College, Chennai. So over to you, sir, for the first session on Approach to Condylar Fractures.
Thank you, Professor Karthikeyan. First, a few words about the speaker, Dr. Surya. When we asked for the TANPAPS prize regarding the journals, publications, Dr. Surya flooded my mail with about 20 publications, all published within 1 year. So much is his academic interest, and I appreciate that, and I am glad that such a young and dynamic person is heading our specialty at Savita. Next, about the topic today, condylar fractures is the most controversial topic in facio-maxillary surgery, be it the approach, be it the management, or be it the post-operative mobilization. Each aspect of it is debatable. Now, let us hear from Dr. Surya about the approaches to the condyle. Yes, Surya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind introduction. Let me share my screen. So good evening, everyone. Thank you, GK sir, for the opportunity. And it's my pleasure to have moderated my topic with Professor JJM, Approach to Condylar Fractures. Just to introduce you to fractures, condylar and subclavian fractures, they constitute about 26 to 40% of all mandibular fractures. And given the unique geometry of the condylar and the head and the TM joint, these fractures can result in marked pain, dysfunction, or deformity if not recognized and treated appropriately. Just a few points about surgical anatomy, especially one is these supratemporal vessels, which are important, especially when you're doing the pre-auricular approach. The other one is the retromandibular vein when we're going ahead with the retromandibular approach. And the other obvious one is the facial nerve, which exits the stellar major foramen and uses five branches and the specific mention and to the marginal mandibular nerve. A few muscles at play here. The important one is the masseter and the medial pterygoid. They together form the pterygomastoidic sling, which is important to incise and go to access the ramus and the condyle. And the other one is the dactyl pterygoid. It has two heads, the upper head and the lower head. The lower head one, which attaches to the condyle head and fractures the condyle, displaced immediately because of the action of this muscle. The entire mandible as such is akin to a bowstring concept, wherein you have pressure at the symphysis, and the only rotational movement permitted is at the condyles. So hence fracture are common at these places. Just a word of mechanism of injury. One, you can have a blow to the jaw, and this causes an ipsilateral parasymphysis and a contralateral condylar fracture. A fall to the ground with the hit to the mentum will cause a symphysis mental fracture with a bilateral condyle, and a dashboard injury in RTA will cause generally cause a bilateral parasymphysis with a bilateral condyle injury. There can be many permutation combinations among these variations. Coming to the examination, mal occlusion is highly diagnostic. An anterior open bite suggests bilateral condylar fractures or angle fractures. A class three, angle three classification is seen in condylar or angle fractures again. And a prognathic or an angle two classification is generally seen with the TMJ effusion. I'll just elaborate on that. So here we have an effusion. So this causes the distraction of ipsilateral ramus, and this causes a posterior open bite, and the midline is shifted to the contralateral side. In a case of a unilateral fracture dislocation, there's a telescoping of the ipsilateral side of the ramus, and this causes a premature gagging of the molars, and the midline is shifted to the side of fracture. So this is very classical here, and you have an open bite. I show a clinical photograph. So here we have a fracture of the condyle on the right side. So we have premature gagging of the molars here. This is an open bite. And you see the midline shift to the side of fracture. We have bilateral fracture dislocation. There's telescoping of both the rami, and this causes premature gagging of the molars on both sides. And this causes an anterior open bite, like so. So here you can see the premature gagging of both the molars on both the sides. This causes an anterior open bite. X-rays are generally are fine, like PAVO, lateral oblique, Townes, OPGs. OPG is particularly useful, especially in condylar fractures. CT scan is a gold standard. MRI can be done in case we have any associated TMJ pathology associated with that. This is OPG showing the bilateral condylar fracture, the reverse Townes and a PAVO. And this is the CT scan. Just a word about classification. The AOCM classification is pretty simple. They divide into head, neck, and the subcondylar lesion. So basically, you draw a line along the posterior border of the ramus and a drop a perpendicular along the sigmoid notch. So anything below sigmoid notch is classified as subcondylar fractures, and anything above is the neck. Head is that region which is the articular surface and a few millimeters beyond it, mostly intracapsular. Neck is further classified as a high neck and a low neck. So what's the dilemma? Deciding on the correct treatment is often more difficult than administering the treatment itself. So what are the goals of therapy we take into? So one is pain relief. You need a stable occlusion, a restored inter-incisional opening, a full range of mandible excursion, minimal deviation, and avoiding growth disturbances and ankylosis. Treatment, there are two schools of thought. One is conservative or functional, another surgical. Conservative could be just exercise, soft diet, analgesics, and probably elastics for 2 to 3 weeks. The idea is to get an inter-incisional distance of about 40 millimeters, more than 10 mm of lateral excursion, and more than 12 millimeters of protrusion, and the exercises are given accordingly. So what are the indications for open reduction and internal fixation in condylar fractures? Any degree of malocclusion, a fragment angulation of more than 30 degrees, a bone gap of more than 2 millimeters, any lateral override, loss of contact of the fracture segment, any low dislocated subcondylar fractures, a ramus shortening of more than 5%, a bilateral fracture with an open bite, and any fracture disc dislocation. So anything which prevents a normative action is an indication for RIF. Generally, IMF is kept from pediatrics for about 2 to 3 weeks, adults about 4 weeks. A longer period may be required in fractures which are comminuted, in alcoholics, or in handicaps. Coming to approaches, there are about 4 approaches. One is the preauricular, you have retromandibular. So, submandibular is generally not used much for a condyle. And the other is a facelift approach, or a right atomy approach. In our unit, we generally follow the retromandibular approach, especially the retroparotid for fractures of the subcondyle, and a preauricular antiparotid approach for fractures of the neck or the head. We've started doing the intraoral and endoscopic assisted in a few cases as well. So I'll just give you a little details on that. So first, the retroperitoneal approach. Here, the incision made 2 centimeters posterior to the ramus. So this is a vertical incision posterior to the ramus. So deep into the skin, up to the platysma. And then you can dissect all the way up to the perioperative capsule. So once you come to the perioperative capsule, you can decide either you want to go transperitoneal or a retroperitoneal. Transperitoneal, again, it has problems by going to perioperative injury, xylocele, etc. So generally, we do the retroperitoneal method where we lift the perioperative off anteriorly and go. And then you'll be on the you'll see the messenger and the telemessage link, which needs to be incised to gain access to the demo and the contact. It's a clean picture of the incision, and then we're cutting into the telemessage link, the fracture being exposed, and this is the plating done. This is a patient with the panfacial fracture, hanging condyle component. In fact, it also has a coronoid component on that. So here again, we proceed with the terminal approach. Here we need it. We need to go through the parotid. So you can see a branch of the facial nerve in the. It's the branch of the facial nerve here. It's been retracted. And here we use a delta plate. Generally, plates, we use 2 mm plates. We generally can use 2 plates. Using 1 delta plate gives the same stability as using 2 plates. And this is the same patient showing the post-op radiographs. And this is OPG with the delta plate in situ. The fracture reduced. This is a 2-month post-op picture showing good occlusion and a good inter-incisal opening. This is another patient with a right subcondylar fracture. So again, we went through the retroparotid approach. The parotid is retracted anteriorly, and this is the plate, and this is the post-op picture, OPG. OPG is good for contact fractures. It gives you a panoramic view, and there's no overlap. And it's a good alternative to PA or reverse tones. This is another patient of a subcondylar fracture. So here you see the angle of the mandible, bottom of the mandible, and this is the incision line. So this is after we go through the fracture line later, and this is the post-op. So ideally, 2 plates is ideal, one along the posterior border and one about 45 degrees to that. Otherwise, one single delta plate or a 3D plate will suffice. This is another patient, the fracture of the right subcondyle. Went to the retroparotid approach, retromandibular approach. This is the plate, and this is the post-op picture again. Another patient of a subcondyle. So this approach is very ideal for subcondyle. You have good access, and the only thing you need to be careful here is the retromandibular vein, which comes into the thing. So just prevent damage to that. Blind dissection is avoided in this region. And this is the post-operative X-rays. So the other approach, what we generally use in our unit is the preauricular approach. We use the preauricular anterior parotid approach. So the incision is made hugging along the tragus, deepened through the temporoparotid fascia. Now the deep temporal fascia splits into a superficial layer and deep layer at the zygomatic arch level, which contains the temporal pad of fat. So the incision is taken up to the superficial layer of the deep temporal fascia and then elevated. As you elevate it, all the nerves, the auditory temporal nerve, the facial nerve, as well as the superficial temporal vessels are safely in the skin flap. And then you go ahead, dissect down into the head and the neck region of the condyle. This is a slight modification of the procedure where we make a little downward incision. Incision is not hard and fast. You can always extend as and when required. And this is exposure and the plated, and this is the post-op suture line. This is a case of bilateral condyle fracture, especially of the neck. So here the parotid is retracted posteriorly. So we go on, this is an anterior parotid, preauricular anterior parotid transmissaric approach. So retract the parotid posteriorly, split the masseter, and you'll be sitting on the fracture. And the only issue with the preauricular approach is you need to have very good retraction. And this is the post-operative X-ray. There's another patient of a lower condylar neck fracture. Again, plated, this is the closure, and this is the Y plate in situ. Another patient of a right condyle fracture, retracted posteriorly, fracture exposed, plated. There's one more called a modified Blair approach, which is generally used for parotid surgeries. So this is basically a combination of a pre-auricular as well as a retro-mandibular approach. So you go along the triggers, skirt along the earlobe, and drop it down on the posterior border of the mandible. So this gives you a better exposure, larger exposure, and so this is the postoperative view of that. Another patient from modified bladder approach, opened up, divided, opened up the fascia, and you have the fracture plated, and the closure. So basically, the preauricular gives you a good access to the head and the neck fractures, and the retroperitoneal approach gives you good access to the subcondyle area, the sigmoid and subcondyle area. A few more examples. This is the left subcondyle fracture with the fractus symphysis, and this is the picture post in the post-op after plating. Another patient with the bilateral condyle and parasymphysis. This is the postoperative after plating. The patient with left condyle with the symphysis. You can see the deviation of angle of deviation of the jaw to the ipsilateral side to side of fracture with trismus. Another patient with left condyle with the right body. Left condyle with symphysis. So here we use two plates. This plate shows, so one here on the posterior border, and the second plate is at 45 degrees angle to that. So a lot of combinations can happen. A few clinical pearls in condyle fracture reduction. So initially, first put a screw onto the fracture segment, the distal fracture segment, and then you give a traction. You need downward traction to align the segments. That can be given either by a bite block, or use a thumb wrapped in gauze and give a downward traction. That helps. Regarding the plating, I will talk in reference to the fracture line. The first screw will be on the proximal part of the distal segment. This is the distal fracture segment. The second screw will be on the proximal part of the mandibular part. Third will be distal of the fracture segment condyle. And the fourth, last screw will be on the distal part of the mandible. So that will be proximal, distal. This is with reference to the fracture line. Plating, as I told before, you can use one plate around the posterior border. If there's enough bone available, a secondary plate is advised. Instead of two plates, nowadays we can use a delta plate. Delta plate gives the same stability as using two plates. Endoscopic, we've started doing a few cases. So what do we need? We need a 30-degree, 4-millimeter endoscope. We need a 90-degree screwdriver, a light source with a suction irrigating device. So this picture shows the 90-degree screwdriver. So this has got a hole to hold the drill bit on the screw, and this is a fork. The fork holds the screw in situ, and this is where we screw the screw in position. A few pictures of endoscopic assisted ORIF. This is the setup, what we have. I'll have a small clip to show you. So this is the instrument pad where we have all the drill bits and screws, and this is a 90 screwdriver. So we pick up the drill bit here, and this is the fork which holds the drill bit or the screw in situ. Yes. So this is the 6, 8, and 12 mm drill bits there. So the screw is in position, and this is held in place with this fork here. And this we're using a 3D plate here. So this is how it goes. So here now we're going to drill into the bone. Yeah. Then, yeah. And now we're tightening the screw on the plate, onto the fracture, onto the bone. So this is another patient which we had done an endoscopic assisted procedure. Use a white plate. A few complications to be noted. The immediate ones are facial lobe injury and vascular injury specific to the superficial temporal vessels or the retroperitoneal vein. This compression for 10 minutes will cease the bleeding there. Other complications include infection, a xyloseal in case we go through a transparent approach, malunion, nonunion, ankylosis, asymmetry, TMJ dysfunction, and the disturbance of normal growth pattern in children, as the condyle is one of the growth centers for the ramus and the mandible. A few take-home points. So basically, initially assess the fracture clinically and confirm with 3D CT, and then plan your how you want to proceed, whether it's operative or non-operative. In case operative, the anesthesia is important. You need to go with the nasal intubation. Else, you can do it with the submental intubation. Head and neck fractures, preferably go with the preauricular anti-liberative approach. Retromandibular approach for subcondylar fractures. Just be careful about the facial nerve and the retromandibular vein. And there are indications for non-operative. In case occlusion is intact, or if the fracture is intracapsular or pediatric, or we have a sagittal split of the condyle with not much in decrease in the posterior facial height. So in those cases, non-operative will suffice. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.
That is a very nice presentation, Sudhya, about the various levels of the fracture and the condyle and the way you go ahead with managing the fractures. I'm really glad that you're getting trained in the intraoral way of exposure using a endoscope.
Yes.
Actually, it's the most difficult one.
Yes.
That being, especially, it's got a steep learning curve. I'm glad that you are getting trained in that.
Yes.
And the main concerns about the various exposures are, one, you should have an adequate exposure. Various incisions are there. You should give an adequate exposure for your fixation. Then the other things you mentioned should not injure the facial nerve, should not produce a pleurotic fistula or a xylocele, and the scars should be minimal. So by this intraoral approach, you take care of the facial nerve because you're going to endoscopically, you're seeing it, you're taking care of the pleurotic, and the scar is not going to be there externally. But the exposure is limited.
Limited, yes.
So it requires quite amount of training. So how do you place the screws when you do an intraoral approach? How do you place the screws? Do you make punctures through the skin to place the screws?
No, sir. Initially, to the plate?
Excuse me.
You are showing the particular instrument.
Yes, sir.
For
yes, sir. That,
you are able to tighten it right to the
yes, sir. To the bone? Initially, we found it difficult, sir. So then we had a transbuccal trocar.
Just
and then we should tighten it.
Can you just please stop sharing your screen?
Yes, sir. So initially we had difficulties. So we started off using a transbuccal trocar, and then used that to tighten the screws. Because the initial we had borrowed the Nendiger screwdriver from a company, so that was not holding the screw properly. So later we changed that, and I think we've done about 10 cases, and slowly we started just avoiding the transbuccal approach, transbuccal trocar system, and using this to tighten the screws. It is difficult, sir. There is quite a steep learning curve. Initially, actually, it's ideal for high neck fractures, but we started out doing for little more low neck or subcondylar regions, and then we slowly will progress to high neck fractures.
So before this advent of this intraoral approach, the only way you can avoid a scar being seen is the coronal approach, where you deglove right from the scalp up down to the condyle.
Right.
The other thing is the facelift approach, where you can hide the scar.
Yes.
In the facelift incision.
Right.
But facelift gives quite a good amount of exposure where you can actually see the nerves and go ahead. But the time taken is much more because you have to identify, though you have a good exposure, time taken, it takes a longer time.
Right.
And about this, what do you do for the head fractures? You have shown number of neck fractures and subcondylar.
Head fractures generally, sir, one is either the head is pulled into the medially, sir, or the head is pulled up into the infranodal fossa. If occlusion is maintained, sir, we leave the head in situ, sir. We don't take it out. If there's any issue and in occlusion or closure, then we remove the head, sir. We remove the head and just put the patient on elastics, IMF, and leave it, sir.
Each institution has got their own protocol. We treat all head fractures, intracapsular fractures conservatively, because you cannot not able to apply any plate on that.
That's true.
There's a way of fixing it also. So we can apply a lax screw.
Lax screw,
going right from the bottom into the head, but it's long process, and we conservative management we adopt for this head. Whereas all neck and subchondylar fractures, we go ahead and fix it. The indication of it for our naval institute, the indication for fixation is a fracture in the neck and the subchondylar region.
This is because
we have observed, we have done some studies, we found out even though the immediate post-operative period after the conservative management with IMF is good, over the period of 6 months, when you see there's a gradual shift of the chin towards the affected side. This is because the vertical height is not maintained if you don't fix it. So from that time onwards, we started fixing all neck and subchondylar fractures by surgical.
Agreed, sir.
That is what we do.
Yes, sir. I think we follow the similar protocol, sir. I think head, we just leave it, sir. And if there's a fracture beyond that, we plate it, sir.
So the only indication is when the patient refuses.
True. Or the patient is really sick or something. Yes, that's true.
The other thing is for children. Children, we manage conservatively.
Yes, sir.
And then we start early mobilization, because it is possible that a good remodeling can occur in children.
Yes, sir.
We do treat conservatively, and the period of immobilization is short, only for 10 days. After start, we start mobilizing. I'm sure you will also be following the same protocol only for.
Yes.
So regarding these approaches, we take for all, we do only retromandibular approach.
Retromandibular approach.
That is, we make an incision, whether it's a neck fracture, we go between the zygomatic and the buccal fractures. I mean, branches of the fascia.
Branches of fascia.
If it is going to be the subchondylar fracture, we go between the buccal branch and the marginal mandibular. Actually, once you make an incision and you reach inside the parotid capsule, actually the retromandibular vein is a good marker to go in front of the retromandibular vein. In front of the retromandibular, we can avoid the external carotid, and the marginal mandibular nerve always lies posterior and lateral to it. So when you make incision anterior to the retromandibular vein,
yes sir,
go towards the masseter, it is always we are keeping the marginal mandibular nerve away from the line of your approach. And once we reach the masseter, we are not particular to reach the posterior border where to go and cut the pterygo mesenteric skin.
Because
if you leave a bit of
cuff of muscle to suture there,
closure. We can suture it.
Yes, sir.
We can close it nicely.
Yes, sir.
And when we make the incision in the parotid capsule itself, the parotid mesenteric fascia, we take stay sutures in that. It is because to get a good closure, because after some time it is starting putting the plate and may not be able to identify this fascia.
Good point.
We're all blood stained and other things, so we take sutures and keep them. And once you do a good closure of the parotid mesenteric fascia and then do a good repair of the SMAS, then the chances of getting a xylocele or the parotid fly is very less. And do you use a nerve locator?
Yes, sir. Preoperative approach, yes, sir. We use a nerve locator, sir.
So we make an incision. Once we see a nerve, because sometimes when you go higher up, the people now also
come. True.
To identify the facial nerve is quite useful, but we dissect for particular.
If it comes in view, we stimulate it.
It is always better once we see a nerve to dissect 1 centimeter both proximally and distally, so that you can nicely retract. So without dissection of that, if you try to push them naturally, you may get a neuropraxia. So that is one way you can avoid neuropraxia. So being a plastic surgeons doing a loop magnification, the nerve injury should not be a problem at all for us. You said about the traction of the mandible by using a bite block during surgery, isn't it? By pushing the molar and all. What we do is we make to the proximal fragment, we make a small drill hole, pass wire, SS wire, 26
wire, wire, and pull it.
Of course, you also be doing that because that's a nice way of retracting it.
Yes.
Using a bone holding forceps will traumatize the skin, as well as putting the fingers, pushing the molar, the bite block.
Yes,
for good, right. Getting a good occlusion, these things might be a disturbance.
Correct. So
for attaining a good occlusion, we just make a small hole, hold it with SS wire and pull it.
And pull it. Yes.
And the thing about the sequence, of course, you'll be doing that. When there's a fracture, other fractures in the mandible, we fix them.
First with others, and then, yes, true, sir.
Before coming to this.
Yes, sir. In case the occlusion is achieved, then we can just stop with that and put an IMF and leave it.
Make an incision, expose the condyle fracture.
Yes, sir.
Then go and fix the other fractures in the mandible. Then do a temporary IMF.
And then?
At the time of applying the plate, the teeth should be in IMF.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes.
So, but this IMF also should not be too rigid, because we may not be able to pull the mandible to adjust.
Yes. Yes.
So it should be slightly loose so that you can adjust the proximal fragment of the mandible before applying the plates. And as you said, the main advantage of this delta plate is that proximally, even if the bone is very less, you have got only one limb there.
One, yes.
Whereas it diverges nicely down bottom at bottom so that you can fix it in the proximal fragment. That's good.
Yes.
And about this, the only care you told about the how to protect the facial now and other things, especially when you go above the level of the zygomatic arch, you should take all the care to avoid the temporal branch of the temporal facial now. So if you keep deeper to the temporal parietal fascia, because the facial now just runs on the undersurface of the temporal parietal fascia.
Correct.
So in this region, of course, we'll be keeping it the incision and deepening it just anterior to the superficial temporal vessels.
Yes, yes.
And where the auriculotemporal node also goes behind. So in between those divisions of the superficial temporal and the maxillary artery, in that V shape, we go deeper in the case of a pre-auricular incision. But we are able to manage most of the things with retromandibular incision itself by doing a retraction. And you mentioned specifically about the retroperotic approach.
Yes, sir.
Retroperitoneal approach, but what he showed is the transperitoneal approach.
Yes, sir.
Transperitoneal approach.
Yes, sir.
Because we find again, if you go more than behind the parotid, all this external carotid artery, the retromandibular vein, all these things manage the problem. Better to go through across the parotid transmesenteric. That is the best way to reach the mandible.
Yes.
Recently, there was an article from Philippines. It's only a case report which says that you make, to avoid the facial nerve and the parotid, we make a small incision in the near the angle of the mandible, then make a tunnel, properiosteal tunnel, right up to the level of the fracture. Of course, we have to make a pre-auricular incision to expose the proximal fragment. There is not much dissection done for the distal, to expose the distal fragment. This tunnel, which is coming from the angle right up to the fracture site, is made with a freer using the elevator.
Okay, sir.
And they pass a long 16-millimeter titanium plate, 16-hole titanium plate through the tunnel and bring it there up there. And proximally, they fix it into the proximal fragment. Distally, they don't fix anywhere here. They fix it close to
the angle.
Lower border. So that the nerve is not exposed, nothing, because we go quite deep towards the fracture. I think that's a good thing.
Nice approach.
Only thing, the plate is quite long for fracture fixation, the single plate.
Yeah.
And we should only actually try to see, because it is going to minimize the time and there's going to be absolutely no injury for the nerve, for the gland and the nerve. I think that's a good idea.
Yes, I'll look into it, sir.
And what about the scars? Have you evaluated the scars after the surgery? How good are the patients? Happy about it?
Yes, sir. A few of them, they have slight hypertrophy, sir, but otherwise most of them are well settled, sir. Give the kinakot massage and all in the skin and skin crease lines are still, so I don't think much of a problem with scars, sir. So far, sir.
So it's very nice about, I'm very impressed about your doing it through the transoral approach.
Thank you so much.
And that's a good thing all the young plastic surgeons should learn. Is it because as we go more towards more and more aesthetic, absolutely patients may not want to have even a single scar on the externally, especially the celebrities. So this is the thing. the need of the day to learn.
Yes, sir.
The intra-world approach.
Sure, sir.
Glad you're doing that.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Any questions in the chat box, Dr. GK?
Yes, sir. There are a few questions.
Yes.
One is, I've asked the question, have you had a situation where you planned conservative management for the condylar fracture but had to do an open reduction later?
No, sir.
Maybe I want to answer that.
No, sir. No, sir. So
see,
far, not.
My thing is, for the head fractures, we take only conservative management. As I told, all the neck fractures and subchondylar, go ahead and fix it because there's enough surface for there for us to fix, unless it is comminuted. When it's comminuted, there's no other choice than to go for conservative management. After that, there is, of course, if we take all the post-operative care of doing IMF for 3 to 4 weeks, after that, we start vigorous mobilization to avoid an ankylosis. And in spite of all these, of the patient being uncooperative, goes for ankylosis, then there's no other way. In order to achieve the mouth opening, we have to go and open up and release the ankylosis. And if it's going to be an excision of a bone block, there's no other go. And Sudhir has already told about that it may require excision and we've got as a pseudo joint. And of course, we're doing all sorts of this interposition arthroplasty by pushing in some temporoparietal fascia and those things. So it is a management of a secondary complication. We may have to go and manage it in the case of a fracture which has been managed conservatively earlier.
There is another question from Dr. Gopi. What are the sites of the endoscopic ports? The site of the ports?
So, there's no sites. We go intraoral straight away. The other one, initially I told you we should go to a transbuccal trocar. But now everything is intraoral, sir. Just put in the endoscope for vision, the 30-degree angle endoscope, sir, so that we can see. And then we use an anterior screwdriver and manipulate the fracture and fix it, sir. So there's no scars outside. There's no entry or exit point, sir.
In the intraoral approach, do you have any point where you specifically have the port or anywhere you are? You can have the port?
No, sir, anywhere you want. So it depends where the fracture is. And you can, it's more freestyle, sir.
There is one question from Dr. T. Krishnamurti on the YouTube comment box. One of the problems you face with the upper fragment buckling inside. Have you had this problem and how would you tackle this problem?
Yes, sir. There is, there is a medial displacement of the proximal the head. So, in case it interferes with occlusion, yes, sir, we go and remove that fragment. But if occlusion is maintained, then we just try and leave it there. So, because going in blindly into the depths and digging out the bone fragment, a lot of complications, a lot of bleeding issues, and it's not advised as advisable. So this, if the medial segment, if the segment is shifted much medially, then we leave it in situ. So, if the occlusion is maintained.
We give it a try. See, it's the medial segment being pulled, the upper segment being pulled medially is because of the pull of the lateral pterygoid. We, of course, ask for a full muscle relaxation to the anesthetist. And then, as Sudhir told, we'll try to get a proper occlusion. If the occlusion is achieved, well and good. Mm-hmm. We have to go ahead with managing it conservatively, only with IMF. And of course, if the occlusion is not achieved, there's no point in stopping the procedure at that point. We have to do something because the final ultimate requirement is the occlusion that we have to achieve.
There are no more questions in the chat box, sir. Perhaps if you can invite comments from the audience. Jay James, sir, you can ask specific questions or just ask for comments from the audience, sir.
Of course, it depends upon how much you are exposed to the surgery and the fascia maxillary. Of course, the ultimate requirement is there to take care of, to avoid the complications. The only complications, as we already mentioned, is the facial nerve. You should know the good anatomy, know the knowledge, have a good knowledge about the anatomy of the facial nerve, and how to close this pelotic fascia and this mask layer. So, Sudhya, was there any time you asked for a tracheostomy? How frequently you ask for a tracheostomy? It's only for this condylar and just fractures of the mandible.
No, sir. We just went for either nasal intubation or a submental, sir. So far, no need for a tracheostomy.
Yes, it has been for us also. Only, of course, in panfacial,
that's
the best thing. But unless the anesthetist wants, we never ask for this.
Yes.
And anything the audience can ask if they have any doubts, because Sudhya has given a good complete presentation about the presentation of the facial fractures, the mode of injury, the level of injury, and then how we manage it, the post-operative mobilization, how long we can you give, once more, can you tell about the how for the adults, what is your post-operative regime? How do you mobilize them?
Yes, sir.
I suppose that you don't, after you fixed, you don't advise immobilization at all.
No, sir. We just keep elastics for about 2 to 3 days, and then we take it out. Take it off, sir.
We do keep the arch bars. Well, if there's
Yes.
So that we can apply these elastic bands and adjust if there's any deviation. That will be quite helpful for the immediate post-operative period for a few days.
Yeah.
So otherwise, it is not necessary to immobilize at all.
True, sir.
For cases which are fixed.
Yes.
And what is your, for this IMF when you do, you have already mentioned about the period. Can you once more repeat the period of immobilization for conservative
Manage? Yeah, for children, we just keep it for about 2 to 3 weeks, sir. For adults, we go up to 6 weeks. And people who are a little handicapped, who are difficult to handle, alcoholics, or people who come with late fractures, so then we do a longer period, so probably what, 12 weeks or so.
So what is the post-operative advice you give to the patient? What is the post-operative advice you give to the physiotherapist?
Post-operative, I think so. We just give elastics the following day, sir. And then we tell them for only liquid diet. And after about 2 to 3 days, we start them on slow mouth opening, little lateral excursions, and specific.
Suppose if a trismus develops after some time, after trismus, he's not able to adequately open the mouth.
Yes, sir.
How do you give physiotherapy?
We use a top to open up.
Bite blocks.
Bite blocks. Yeah. So slowly increases the bite block size and get into at least near normal.
There is another question in the chat box, sir, from Dr. Purushottaman, sir. Getting occlusion will not be a problem in displaced condylar fractures. Getting the occlusal cant horizontal may be the problem. He's made a comment on that. And Dr. T. Krishnamurthy has followed up his question on the YouTube. The answer to my question was most probably to pull the lower fragment by wire or any other means, or deliver the head with a skin hook and get the alignment. Or if the space is adequate, you can use the Folkman's scoop. So that's just a comment from Dr. T. Krishnan.
Yeah, skin hook, we've tried, sir. We've tried skin hook.
Okay.
It works. It works, sir.
Yeah, I think we have just a minute or a couple of minutes more. If you can, Dr. JJM can sum up. Or...
So we have got a number of approaches. The topic has been on the approaches of the condyle. And the indications for the condylar fixation, as I told from our point of view, from MMC point of view, it is only the neck and the subcondyle. And even Dr. Sudhya also has approved the same thing. So the fractures of the head will be treated conservatively. And actually, there's a classification for the head fractures, dicapitular fractures, where type 1, where there's a fracture, the vertical height of the mandible is still maintained. So that will do well in spite of being a head fracture, it will do well with conservative management. Whereas the type 2 and type 3, where there's a displacement, the lateral displacement and medial displacement might cause problems. But we can try to achieve good alignment by doing only an IMF. And after that, vigorous post-operative mobilization after the period of immobilization is over. Then, regarding these various approaches, the pre-auricular, the other approaches close to the ear, namely the endoral approach and the retroauricular approach, which has gone out of favor because they can cause meatal stenosis because we're going to interfere with the auditory canal. So those things don't give much of exposure advantage, but can cause stenosis of the auditory canal. So these things are not very popular. Whereas the pre-auricular, of course, we routinely use pre-auricular incision for releasing the TM joint ankylosis because we have to go right up to the bone under the glenoid to excise the bone block. So that is the condition where we have used the pre-auricular approach. And for the management of a fracture, our standard we are able to reach through the retromandibular approach, transparotid, transmesitric. And submandibular, of course, is not used at all because not only the scar is bad, it doesn't give an exposure to the, maybe it might be helpful for subcondylar, low subcondylar fractures, but definitely cannot reach the neck. So weight is not necessary also. And you're putting the marginal mandibular nerve into further into peril. So it's not of much use. So the advantage what we get by doing this facelift, where we get a good exposure, we can achieve by doing a retromandibular approach. Now there's called mini retromandibular approach. You make only a 2 centimeter incision, but of course it requires good experience to make the incision smaller, go through it, take care of the nerve, go between the branches of the nerve and reach your target fracture site, deglove enough to apply your plate. And the retromandibular approach is very good because it gives a direct lateral view on the lateral aspect of the mandible, where you can apply screws directly onto the bone without any angulation. You are able to do it very, especially for the subcondylar fractures. I mean, you have to look a little higher up for the case of the neck fractures. And the incidence of facial nerve paralysis is almost nil. There could be, I don't say there won't be any neuropraxia. Once there is neuropraxia, we start the patient for 5 to 5 days of with corticosteroids we give. The recovery takes time. Maybe within a few days it will recover. Within a period of 4 weeks, it definitely recovers usually. Because once you know that your surgical care is good, then there is not any problem about the facial.
Thank you.
So if there are any questions, we can answer.
Yes, sir. I think there are no more questions, sir. I think that was a wonderful compendium on approaches to condylar fractures, almost like
a
textbook.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, JK, for the opportunity. Thank you, Surya.
Thank you, Jayjam, sir. Thank you so much.
It was wonderful. And since it is being uploaded, it will be uploaded on YouTube. I think it will be a great accompaniment for people studying, postgraduate studying, or even consultants who are doing their practice. Thank you so much again, Dr. Surya and Professor JJ.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir.